Praise the Lord and God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Welcome to the Revelation Salisbury. I hope the Revelation today. God bless you. I hope that you're having a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful day in the Lord. Amen. And that you're enjoying what God is doing in the services today. God bless you. We thank God for you. I'm Bishop James Kirksey here with the Revelation Today, Revelation International Ministries. We're here to share a word with you today about this is love. This is love. Today we're starting a sermon series called This is Love, and it's all about love here on this blessed day, amen, that we celebrate and we think about the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is alive. He is alive, and he is alive and well. Hallelujah, that he is alive. Praise God for that. Amen. Today we're going to start our series. The first message will be called Love That Forgives Our Sins. Love That Forgives Our Sins. Amen. So good morning to all of you. God bless you. Those that are watching around the world, we thank God for you. Amen. So we're going to talk about the resurrection that changed everything. It was because of the resurrection that we know what the cross was all about. Because of the resurrection, we understand the meaning of Good Friday. And at the cross, Jesus died in our place for our sins. And Jesus entered into our pain and our shame. And Jesus came and he took the weight of evil itself. And so its power could be broken from our lives. And because Jesus didn't stay in the grave, we can see that the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ is God in his love freeing us from our sin. And God in his love overcoming death. And God in his love announcing that one day a new creation will come forth. Because of the death and resurrection of Jesus, we see the love of God. When we look at Jesus, we can say, this is love. Amen. I want to talk to you today about the first part of about God and his love freeing us from sin. Because, you know, sin is not a very popular word. And actually, sin can be a confusing word for some. But so let me tell you a story about a man. This man woke up and he heard a crash, and not a loud crash, but a crash nonetheless. And before he could peel himself out of bed, he heard the pitter-patter of little feet running up the stairs. He heard Dad, a little five-year-old girl, said to him innocently in her sweet voice, "Will you make us breakfast?" He said, "I'm sure. What happened just now?" he asked. Groggedly. "Well, we're actually starving, Dad, and we tried to make ourselves some oatmeal." "I guess the rest," the dad asked, "guessed the rest," and they had thought, well, their older brother Jonas had successfully gotten oatmeal into a bowl and filled it with water and put it in the microwave, but they had misjudged how hot the bowl would be when the oatmeal was ready. Dropping a hot bowl was human reflex. I wasn't mad about the bowl. It wasn't old and expensive, but I was puzzled at why they didn't come and ask for help. They had tried to clean up the mess of oatmeal and broken pottery with a mop unsuccessfully, and now the mop was run too. And why didn't you guys just ask for help? We could have helped you and cleaned up the mess. Before they could respond, the answer became apparent. It's hard enough to ask for help, but it's even harder when we ask for help to clean up a mess that we made. That's how we, our adults, are. We don't want to ask God for help. We want to try on our own to clean up the mess that we've made with our own hands. And when a mess ensues and we resist asking for help again, the time, because we're embarrassed or ashamed of it. Asking for help to resolve a mess that we've made is admitting to our faults. And we don't want to admit to the guilt. Because guilt is uncomfortable, and it's uncomfortable feeling, and saying I'm sorry is uncomfortable word. We'd rather deny it and ignore it, recover on our own, and even justify with our own actions, and because we failed, it eats away at us. Our culture doesn't really have a word for this. We tend to psychologize our shortcomings to they can't be recast as a result of someone else's failure, and we're on the very way because of our parents or because of our community or because of our poor education we've received or some other system that's failed us. It couldn't have been our fault. And all of these things are surely true enough, but systems carry part of the blame. But that doesn't erase the problem. If anything, it expands it. It isn't just individuals who failed. It's the entire communities and systems. And still, what is the word for that? The Bible's word for that is simply sin. Sin is a sense of missing the mark or failing to be who God created us to be. It is falling short of the original version or vocation that God's first calling in our lives, and the image bearers who reflect God's wisdom and love and rule into the world. Sin in the sense of missing the mark or failing Him. Sin is also a rebellion and a turn away from God, a decision to move against Him and of independent of Him. Sin is a transgression, a crossing of the lines and boundaries and a violation of another person. And ultimately, sin is a power. It is sin with a capital S that holds us captive and paralyzes us with the shame of that sin. Take all of it together and you realize that sin is dead, is a dead end. It's a grand game over. What do we do now? Well, there's a follower of Jesus who had fallen short in a spectacular way. In fact, his failure was so dramatic that, so epic, his story should have ended there. His name was Peter. He wasn't just one of Jesus' followers. He was one of Jesus' closest friends. And his sin was not just crossing of the line or a minor departure or a coming up a bit short. His sin was a flat-out denial of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not one time, not two times, but three times. It's no wonder then that Peter had gone back to his old way of life. He seemed to be still around the disciples, but he was not quite the same. When they heard the news that Jesus was alive, Peter and John ran to the empty tomb, and John got there first and Peter followed. I imagine tentatively behind John, seeing the grave clothes lying there, stained and soiled in the empty tomb, believed Peter. Well, we don't know what Peter thought, but John doesn't say, but Jesus appears to Mary, calling her by name. Then Jesus appears to the disciples, passing through a locked door, and as if there was not enough, Thomas asks to see his wounds, and Jesus shows him his hands and his feet. Was Peter there in that room with the disciples? John doesn't say. But then the next chapter, John gives a long account of an encounter with Peter and the risen Savior. Peter, who seems to still be on contact with the disciples, announces that he's going fishing, and they say that they'll go with him. Where we're trying to encourage their crestfallen counterpart or friend? Were they trying to keep him company in the midst of his shame? Who knows? But Simon Peter told them, I'm going fishing. And they said, well, we'll go with you. They've set out a boat, but throughout the night they caught nothing, according to John 21 and 3. But what must Peter have been feeling? Okay, well maybe Jesus is alive, but that only makes things worse for me, doesn't it? Because now I know that I shouldn't have denied him. And Everybody knows that I did, and how could I ever face the Lord Jesus Christ after denying him three times? It's hard to say I'm sorry, especially when the wrong is so very deep. How could Peter recover from this? Peter was supposed to be the leader. He had walked on water. He had confessed Jesus as the Messiah. Now he had denied him. How could he regain any credibility with his friends? It's a wonder that they even wanted to hang around him anymore. You see, this is what shame does. Shame isolates us. It tells us that we're the only ones. It says that our sin is uniquely disqualifying, that no one else ever done anything quite like it. It makes us the exception, the worst way, and we're the one person who can't be forgiven. We've done the one thing that can't be set right. We've gone past the point of return. We've fallen too far. Shame tells us it's game over. It's the end. And in a sense, it's true. Sin is dead end. Sin is a dead end. Or as the Bible puts it, the wages of sin is death, according to Romans 6:23. Shame, the kind that comes from actual guilt, is not a liar. It just tells us the story as it stands without Jesus Christ. Jesus shows us up that day in the midst of Peter's fishing trip. And it says in John chapter 21, in verse 4 through 7, it says, early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples didn't realize it was Jesus. And Jesus called to them, "Children, have you caught anything to eat?" And they answered him and said, "No." He said, "Cast your nets on the right side of the boat and you'll find some." So they did, and there were so many fish that they couldn't haul in the net. Then the disciples whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It's the Lord." When Simon Peter heard it was the Lord, he wrapped his coat around himself, for he was naked, and jumped into the water. What I love about this moment is that Jesus meets Peter where he's at. Peter tries to retreat to his old familiar place, to his comfort zone, and Jesus meets him there. Jesus didn't just meet Peter there. Jesus reenacts the scene of Peter's calling. He was taking Peter back to the start, back to where it all began. But something is radically different this time. Now the resurrection has occurred. Jesus is alive and not with his old life. Jesus is alive and well. Jesus was raised with a new kind of life. His body had been transformed into a new kind of body. Jesus was raised with this new kind of life. And that's part of John's point in telling us things things like Jesus appearing through locked rooms and eating fish on the beach. And there were things about his resurrected body that were like his previous body on the beach. And there were things that were very, very different. Resurrection life is like that. It's a completion and a perfection of all of good and true and beautiful that we now know. The resurrection changes everything. And it changed the way Jesus called Peter as well. When Jesus first called Peter, it was about a purpose. "Follow me and I'll make you fishers of men." This time it was about a person. "Peter, do you love me?" Three times Jesus asked Peter this question about his love. There's a whole sermon in there, but for today, I want you to see this. When we retreat to shame, Jesus comes after us again and again and again. His love will never stop chasing us. His love will never let us go. His love can change everything. What Jesus did for Peter, he wants to do for us. In fact, before he found Peter and spoke to him, he had appeared to his disciples. They were in a locked room and afraid and confused and wondering if Jesus really had been raised from the dead. And if so, what that meant for John writes on the evening of that day, the first of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for the fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins, forgive them." He breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." John 20:19-23. The risen Savior Jesus breathes new life. The life of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead, into his followers, into us. He announces that true peace is theirs, it's yours, it's mine, it's yours. True peace. No more fear, no more shame, no more guilt. Peace, the true and deep sense of being forgiven, of being together with Jesus again, with God our Creator, set right one with another, now in unity. Because of the resurrection, sins can be forgiven. Think of it, our sins, or missing the mark, or falling short, or transgressing, or crossing the lines, are forgiven because Jesus died and rose again. And the power of sin that kept us bound, that paralyzed us, that held us in the same patterns of failure, is now broken. Think about that. To be forgiven is to be free from guilt, free from shame, free from the power that enslaved us, and free from being fully human, to be what God made us to be, to reflect his image right with us, his wisdom, his love into all the world. Peter's life changed that day. He went on to lead the start of the movement that would be called the church. He preached boldly and suffered greatly. He shepherded a flock of believers and taught them what it meant to be forgiven and free. A deep love of Jesus Christ anchored him through even the most difficult of days. Friends, your life can change today. The whole trajectory of your life can change today. Maybe you thought it was game over, that you've hit a dead end, and because of your mistake you've made, or a destructive habit you caught in, I've got good news for you. It's not over. Just as it wasn't over for Peter, or just like it wasn't over when Jesus died on the cross and was buried, it's not over for you. Because Jesus cared enough to carry your sin. Jesus cared enough and carried death and gave victory over your sin and over death. It is not over. It is not the end. The resurrection changed everything. The scripture tells us that God shows his love for us because we were still sinners. Christ died for us in Romans 5:8. While we were enemies of God, while we were stuck in sin, while we were caught in the trap, Jesus came and died for us. And before we knew how to call his name, God came running for us. God comes running after you, just like he came running after Peter. Today is your day. Today, this is love, and it can change everything. Let's pray this prayer today in Jesus' name. Just close your eyes and bow your head, and let's pray this prayer today all together. Dear Jesus, I need your help. I'm stuck. I've hit a dead end. I don't want to admit it, but it's true. I've crossed the line I shouldn't have crossed. I've fallen short of what I know you made me to be. I've failed in my love for you and in my love for others. But still you came for me. You died for me. You were raised up for me, and you called to me. So today I'm saying, Lord, yes, I want to give you my life. I want to love you fully and follow you closely. I know I can't do it on my own. I need your resurrection life. Just as you breathed on your disciples with the Holy Spirit, breathe on me in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer today, I welcome you into the family of God and the kingdom of God, that you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, that he is the Lord of your life and has forgiven you of your sins. I want you to comment and talk to me. Share this video with others. Send me a letter, an email in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's celebrate together. In Jesus' name, God bless you. I turn it over to the hands of the local pastor in the name of Jesus. God bless all those that watch today. God bless you. If you would like to check us out, www.therevelationtoday.com. God bless. I'm Bishop James Kirksey signing off. God bless you. Have a great day.